Good evening, everyone. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. It's my weekly call and radio show, What Would Jeff Do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning on AM 790, talking business around the world on Solid Canine Training Radio. I'm actually doing a podcast webinar. I'm in Ellington, Florida, with a colleague of mine, Tracy's, and I'm in the RV. We're doing an RV webinar. Can't thank everybody enough for tuning in. If you're first time here, welcome. What I'd like you to do is there's a spot that you can do a chat, and you just put in, make sure you type in to admin only, and you can type in your question. If you've got a really long question, what happens is it gets split up between multiple multiple boxes that makes it harder for me to read. So try to keep your questions relatively short. The way that these webinars work is they're all for you. There's a 100-minute webinar, and they're based around your questions. The reason is I get so many questions during the week as far as on Facebook. I get them on Facebook. I get them on Twitter, Instagram, emailed to me. And the only way that I can answer all these questions for no cost is by doing my Monday and Wednesday webinars as well as my my radio show. So it's important that folks get their questions to me. And I'm more than happy to obviously give lots of answers. What we've got to do on today's webinar is we'll be doing 12-minute commercial breaks for my producer for my radio show. All right. So, hey Jay, how you doing? You've got 2 week hours now, both media educators, time to turn up the training. That's wonderful. Yeah, remote collars are really, such a game changer with a remote collar. I mean, the thing is this, is that, you know, remote collars are a wonderful way to have a conversation with a dog, whether they're close to you or they're far away. And it's important that people, hey, Daniel, how are you? Yep, I actually wrote your question down just in case you weren't going to be attending tonight. Daniel wants to know about the treadmill helps build confidence. I'm going to get to that question, Daniel. Thanks a lot for attending my webinar and for posting your comment. I just got it late at night and I pulled in. And I have not had time to do any of my social media today because I was on the road. So there's a question on my Facebook page today. If you're not part of my social media group, just remember, even if you're not on on Facebook, you can still go to my Facebook page, and you can you just can't comment if you're not part of Facebook, but you can see everything. And the reason why I do that is because I put up 6 to 8 posts, a combination of video and photo. And I answer as many questions there as I can. It's just as far as like some of your comments. I can't get into the training on Facebook. It's really challenging for me to do that. Also through email, it's hard. So Daniel asked a great question. How does the treadmill help build confidence? So your average dog, Daniel, does not want to just jump on the treadmill. So they're nervous, they're fearful, they're afraid. They might be thinking they can't do it, but I can't get into the dog's mind like that because that's humanizing the dog. I want them to do it because I know it's good for them. So what happens is I work them through their fear, their anxiety, and I get them on it, and they get on it, and they see they can do it. And that builds confidence. And then the next thing that I ask them to do, which they may hesitate, getting up on a box, crawling underneath something, when you're walking, going over those grates, the sewer grates, or if you're in a big city, you know, the subway grates, or if you want to walk up and down fire fire exits on the sides of buildings. What happens is a couple of things. The dog builds more trust in you, and they build more confidence that they can do things. So a great exercise for puppies, if you were going to get a puppy and raise a puppy, is you get this dog, you only use their food. And what you do is you get this dog to go underneath things, over things, different surfaces. So what you're doing is the way the treadmill builds confidence is the dog is doing something and eventually happily doing it when they before they were afraid to do it. So as a past rock climber, when I would be doing, you know, scaling a wall, if I thought maybe I couldn't do something, but then I did it. I build my confidence in my rock climbing skills. So I hope that answers your question. Caroline, how do I know if I'm getting him enough exercise? We do 220 minutes of Frisbee a day, and that was never enough. Now we're doing 220 minute structured walks a day at a minimum, but usually a little more. He's in place or downstay the rest of the day with me. He's a 2-year-old German Shepherd. So that's a great question. So you've got a 2-year-old German Shepherd doing 40 minutes of walking and 40 minutes of play. I probably would want to work that dog a little bit more. I'm really glad that you're doing the duration work with down in place, because that's really good. I'd work that dog on drills. I would do that, work that dog on doing some drill work, from place to recall to place, place to recall to down, move it back and forth. I would get that dog probably doing longer than a 20-minute walk, you know, get that dog to 30 to 35 to 45-minute walk. Do some little bit more mind games, maybe get the dog into some nose work. You can do that in your own house. German Shepherd's a working dog. You need to work it, but the fact that you're doing duration work is really, really helpful. Right. You're welcome, Daniel. Daniel says thanks. Hopefully that was helpful to you. Let's see. So Caroline says, me and my dog have had a lot of success with your training methods. We have been using the prong and e-collar for a few weeks now and no free roaming for now. I have two questions. That was one of the questions that you asked. Great. Glad you're having so much success. That's really great that you do it. And, you know, this is the thing, is that, you know, the stuff that I teach, they're not necessarily my methods. They're just things that have worked for me. Being a working kennel, we've got the opportunity to work dogs all the time to see, you know, to see if everything we do works. Your second question: I have a 2-year-old nephew. He has pounced aggressively and playfully at a couple times while on a downstay. I had him on a leash with the prong collar next to me. Can you give me some tips to correct him? I've not given him a strong correction yet because I'm not sure what's best. Any tips would help. So the dog pounced on the nephew. You need to make sure that that doesn't happen. So you're probably talking about your German Shepherd dog. So what you need to do is you need to teach that dog better impulse control, but then you also have to make sure you're teaching your nephew proper dog greeting. What I suggest your nephew does at the beginning is just ignore the dog. So my youngest child, I've got 7 children, my youngest being 2, and the 2-year-old child, Angelo, he can walk through a play yard with 15 to 20 dogs, and not once does a dog ever jump on him because he ignores them. But whether the dog is being playful or aggressive, it doesn't matter. Your dog's not allowed to pounce, jump, paw at a child. The only thing that's probably going to be acceptable is, you know, the dog might knock the child over just because it got in the way. But even that, you can start teaching that child, the dogs, about space. So what would I do for the jumping? That would be a correction. All right. So that's what I would do. I would be doing correcting that way. Absolutely do not want a child to be hurt. All right. Sharon asks, how do I get a puggle to do recall? He does it great at home. That probably means inside the house, I would imagine. I did luring with him this weekend. He didn't do his recall. It took me 15 minutes to get him. Well, Sharon, if you're struggling with your dog on recall and it took you 15 minutes to get him, I would ask first, why is the dog off leash? So I would never allow the dog off leash. Any dog that does not know recall should never be off leash. So you can have a 25-foot, 50-foot line outside if you want to. If you want the dog to be running around, But the way we train dogs on recall is to get the best recall possible. In my opinion, we use remote collars. So all dogs are remote collar trained. So I would encourage you to look into remote collar training. You can pair it with food. You can have that dog only eat when it's doing recall. But when a dog's outside with lots and lots of distractions and it's off leash, I'm not surprised that the dog did not come back. I'm not surprised at all. Because the dog doesn't know to come back. You haven't trained it recall. It's coming inside because there's not as many distractions. Outside, all bets are off. Just the air alone, the scent alone, the leaves, other dogs, cars, bicycles, kids, noises. So many things are going to distract the dog coming back to you. So what I would do is I would have that dog on a leash at a minimum, and I would encourage you to do remote collar training. And you would pair that up with food, and I've got a video on that, on how to do that. All right. Carol says, hi, thank you for all your help. I have two dogs. One is more reactive to dogs than the other, but both have made progress with the educator. What do I do when off-leash dogs follow us off the trail? Again, Carol, I'm glad that you're doing remote collar training. But keep in mind, if you can't control your dogs 100%, you cannot let them off-leash. Yeah, you can't. So I would role play that over and over and over again by going to, you know, a local place that has got maybe some trails, and I would work on recall on the trail, recall on the trail. So once you get a strong recall inside, what I would do is I would be really, really cautious about letting a dog that does not have 100% recall off leash in the wilderness. As a backpacker myself, I assure you, if I've got a dog coming to me and I'm with my dogs, I can't let that happen because I don't know if that dog's safe or not. So I would do that. So Carol says they aren't off leash. Okay. So if they aren't off leash, what you can do is if you want to get them off leash, you do the same protocol that I just mentioned by training them to be off leash trained. What you can do is what I like to do with the dogs on the trail is I like the dogs to get ahead of me 5-10 feet, call them back. The other dogs are off leash. That's the hard part about other dogs being off leash in a trail. I mean, this is the thing. As a backpacker, dogs are, you know, when you're at the beach in the off season, dogs are off leash. That's what people do. Whether it's right or wrong, people do just do it. My dogs go swimming in the ocean. So if I'm in an off season at a beach off to the side somewhere and I'm swimming my dogs in the ocean and somebody comes by and says, your dogs are supposed to be on a leash. All due respect, you know, they're swimming in the ocean. Sorry, they know recall and they're not going to be on a leash. And I'm not going to put them on a leash. I'm going to leave. So if somebody, you know, if the authorities come by and say, your dogs have to be on a leash, I'm just leaving. I'll put them on a leash to get to my car, but they're swimming in the ocean. I'm not keeping my dogs on a leash. They could die. They can tangle themselves up and not be able to swim and they could die. So my dogs are not going to be on a leash. But when you've got off leash dogs and you're on the trail, that's the way it works. I know. That's a cop out answer, right? I know. I don't expect dogs to be, I expect dogs, if they're off leash on a trail, all I do is ask them if they come back to their owners. So they have to have recall to their owners. So if you're walking on a trail and a dog comes to you, what I do is I would go off to the side. I'd put my dogs off to the side. And then hopefully you ask the owners, you know, you yell ahead, I've got dogs. And they might say, you know, oh, my dogs are okay. My dogs are friendly. So Carol says, I'm okay with it. Just want to know how to prevent the interaction when the dogs run up to mine. Just get a pet convincer and use the pet convincer. All it is compressed air. Spray the air at them. Pick up some sand or dirt. Throw it at them. Tell them to move away. You can try that. Caroline says, can you let me take a quick break. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show. What would Jeff do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning on AM 790. Talking business around the world on Solid Canine Training Radio. Let's turn on the air, guys. Hold on. and I got to do these commercial breaks because this is going to be played on Saturday during my radio show. So I'll be doing these breaks. Welcome back. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show, What Would Jeff Do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning on AM 790, talking business around the world on Solid Canine Training Radio. And then you ask, what kind of correction would you do with a child there? You know, I'd be really cautious with a child actually there. What I would do is I would start figuring out the dog's state of arousal and get the dog to be working on being calm. So what I would do with a child is I would have that dog in a state of calmness around the child. Down stays in place, down stays in place. And what I would do is I would get the child to run around and get that dog to focus on down in place, down in place. Majid says, hi, Jeff. I have a 10-month-old German Shepherd dog. What is this? It's German Shepherd Day here. He potties during walks, but I want him to potty in a specific spot in the backyard. When I take him to the spot, he just sits and doesn't potty. How can I fix that? If you want a dog to go to the bathroom in one spot in the yard, what you've got to do is you take your dog out on a leash. Best way to do it is first thing in the morning. Take him to that spot. Tell him to go to the bathroom. If he doesn't go to the bathroom, you bring him back in, put him back in his kennel. 10 minutes later, go back out to the spot, go to the bathroom, give him a command, go potty. That's what we use. We say go potty. Give him a command. If he doesn't go to the bathroom, go back inside, put him in the kennel. Dog does not come out of the kennel until he goes to the bathroom. So that's what I would do. So the dog does not go out of its kennel until it goes to the bathroom. If he poops out there, when you're first trying to teach the dog where to go, leave some of the poop out there as well. All right. If you've got any questions, what I'm telling people to do is make it sure you're doing it for admin only. And then what you do is you write your questions in the where it says write your message here. You write your message and it shows up on my screen as well. It's your first time attending one of my webinars. I do them every Monday and Wednesday from 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and I do them for 100 minutes. And I know you can hear the tiredness of my voice today. I'll try to liven it up a little bit. It's been a long, long day of driving. Right now I'm down in Ellington, Florida. I'm going to be down here for about a day and a half visiting with some of my T3 colleagues. I'm eating some barbecue, and then I'll make it up to Gainesville. This weekend, I've got a seminar up in Gainesville, Florida. If you actually go to rvdogtrainer.com, rvdogtrainer.com, you'll actually see my schedule. We're doing some. Actually, I think there may be just one ticket left. Maybe there's two tickets left for a working spot. But audit spots, there's plenty of. And I'm actually doing a half-price audit spot to help out some people. So if you type in thank you, all one word, thank you, into the coupon code box, you're going to see that you only have to pay $100 for a 2-day seminar. So that's pretty incredible. And it's my thank you back, literally my thank you back to the dog owning community. My seminars, these RV dog trainer seminars, are geared towards dog owners. Yes, dog trainers show up, and that's more than fine, but they're geared towards dog owners because I really want to help out as many people as possible. Jay asked, one of my fosters is in and out of sleep right now. I have his collar on. Is it okay to search for his working level while he's in that state, or would it be better when he is up and somewhat alert? I wouldn't use a remote collar on a dog that's trying to go to sleep if that's what your dog is trying to do. I want working levels on dogs that are actively ready to work, not on dogs that are actively trying to sleep. So Jay, so what I would do is I would get him on you find a working level when you're working the dog, when you're getting the dog ready to work. Dog's in a sit or a stand, and you do it in an area that's not really distracted. I've got a video on how to find your working level, and that's how you find the working level of a dog. You want to make sure that the collar is on super snug. I prefer the dog is not lying down, because when the dog lies down, it could put pressure on the collar, and then when the dog stands up, they don't feel it anymore. So you want to give that a shot. Daniel asked, during training sessions, I'd run through all the commands my dog knows. Then I draw a blank on what to do next to keep her engaged. She seems to get bored and lose interest in the same commands over and over. I'm increasing duration, but what other suggestions do you have? You know, Daniel, first of all, kudos to you for training your dog at all. So many people don't. But work on duration. Just work on existing. So you work on the place command, work on down. There's nothing wrong with that. You can run your dog through 5 minutes of fast-paced stuff and then 2 hours of doing nothing. 2 hours of doing nothing you could do. So that's what I would focus on. I would focus more on duration and doing nothing. It really helps a dog's mind to learn how to do nothing. So that's usually what I do. All right. Let's get your questions in. Let's write your questions in on the chat box right underneath. The confidence building we already went over. Somebody asked me about correcting dogs. There was a semi-passive aggressive comment on, which I deleted, by the way, on my Facebook page. The thing about my Facebook page is that it's not a democracy. All right. My Facebook page is my Facebook page, and I control the content. I control the conversation, and I won't put up with any negativity on my page at all. And I won't put up with any snide remarks, and I won't put up with any bashing of me or any of my fans. And people are always surprised. They're always surprised that I would delete a comment and ban a person. Like, of course I would. Like, why wouldn't I? If this is not CNN.com, this is me. It's my page. And I've got an obligation. I've got an obligation to all my fans. And it's called, there's something called the flavor of the page. And if you go through the page, there's a flavor. And of course I do it to showcase the work we do. And if you want to think it's a big ego thing, that's probably makes a lot of sense because I got a big ego. So yeah, of course it is. But on the other hand, let me introduce you to the thousands of people whose dogs have been trained. Can't argue with that now, can you? So the funny thing is that it always blows my mind that, did you know that it takes the same amount of time to say something hurtful to somebody as it does to say something helpful and nice to somebody? Did you know that? Isn't that a weird, weird concept? You can actually be kind to somebody in the same amount of time it takes to hurt them. And I'm always surprised when people wake up in the morning and they want to wake up and make really nasty comments to people. Like, really? Does your life suck so much that you have to derive pleasure out of harming other people? Do you realize that you are a elementary school bully in a 30, 40, 50, 60, 70-year-old's body? Do you know that? That's all you are. You're just a bully. You're just a negative, low self-esteem, miserable bully. Anyway, so somebody asked me about correcting dogs. And it was the one video of the little white dog, and about the dog bites. It's a biting dog. It's bitten everybody in the family. It's a little, one of them little fluffy dogs, you know, I don't know, 10 pounds, 13 pound dogs. And John was doing some drills with it, you know, sit, heel, down, just really quick. He was doing it in the break room. And I mentioned that the dog bites. And somebody asked, you know, how do you stop the dog from biting? That was not the passive aggressive. That was a logical question. So we use an aversive, all right? Plain and simple. I don't hide behind anything I do, right? I correct the dog, all right? I can even make it even simpler for everybody. I make the act of the dog biting uncomfortable and even painful to the dog. Yes, I inflict a 1 second moment of pain to the dog that bites. There you go. Okay. Take that sound clip, separate it, throw it around the internet. It's Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. That's www.solidcaninetraining.com. Send them there. It's always funny when people try to make me look bad, and they send people, they like post one of my videos. It's the best thing ever. I can't imagine a better, my haters probably are some of my biggest supporters, and they don't even know it. It's the funniest thing. It's the funniest thing. So we correct a dog. Just remember, there's 86,400 seconds in a day. We spend probably 3 to 6 of those seconds correcting a dog, and we spend the rest of the day doing awesome, fun stuff. So if you want to put that in the scale, there you go. All right, there you go. It's so funny. It's, you know, I was thinking about this morning. Let me take a quick break, and then I'll tell you what I was thinking about this morning. I was driving. This is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, my weekly call-in radio show, What Would Jeff Do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning on AM 790, talking business around the world on Solid Canine Training Radio. Get my throat spray. Welcome back. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show. I'm actually doing a webinar in Ellington, Florida, down here at a colleague's house, having a great time. Actually, I just pulled in, and then I made a nice dinner. Tonight I had some, I had some leftover potatoes from breakfast or lunch or brunch, right? That's why I call it that. But I made some nice salmon with a nice herb rub on it. And then I had some broccoli. And then I'm drinking my cup of coffee. I had some water. Don't worry, Linda, I'm staying well hydrated. I had my vitamins. Linda was kind enough to put a whole little holistic packet of daily ritual stuff to have. I can't tell you how much I love that woman. Oh, she's incredible. Anyway, let me go through some questions. Peter says, hey, Jeff, hope you're enjoying time in New Orleans. Broadcast that question right there. Have some fun. Jay says, well, when is a good time to praise the dog during duration work? If they've been in place for 5 minutes, what would be the best way to let them know they're doing good without having them break command? Or do I just leave them until it release, or if they break command alone? Like, Jay, leave them alone, right? Just leave them alone. 5 minutes? Come on, Jay. Really? You're impressed with 5 minutes? Give me 50 minutes, Jay. Give me a couple hours. You can always say good, but just be careful. Praise, here's a great concept. Praise can hurt and praise can help. So think of that. Praise can hurt and praise can help. So when can praise hurt is if you say good and the dog gets up, right? So if you say good and the dog gets up, that's when praise starts hurting. If you say good and the dog doesn't move, well, then that's fine. But 5 minutes is no big deal. I want the dog to get into a calm state of mind. Peter, I had a great, I'm not in New Orleans anymore, Peter. Thank you so much. I was in New Orleans right before this. We did something called T3 Accelerate, which is really great. And it's important that New Orleans, it's an incredible city. I love the architecture. And, you know, Bourbon Street was not my thing. You know, I'm sober almost 20 years now. But it was just too crowded with people. New Orleans, go figure. But it was fun. It was fun. The food is really, really great. The food is really, really nice. Music was great. We went to a jazz club, and the location of the seminar was really great. I think we're going to be doing a launch, you know, pretty soon. There. Let me see. Let me just delete some stuff. Okie doke. Majid, if I'm pronouncing your name wrong, I apologize. All due respect. When a dog is in place, can I call them to come to me, or do I need to physically grab the leash and release them? Great question. Now, Majid, you actually can go from a command to a command. So from place, you can say here. So we use the word here. You can do that. Or you can say break. If you say break, that doesn't mean they can, that means they don't have to come to you though. Keep that in mind. That means they can just like walk about. Joy says, hi, Jeff. I admired you. Admire your straightforwardness and training. Can't wait to get your help and training in Gainesville. See you Saturday. Joy, I can't wait to meet you. First of all, thank you for the very kind words. I cannot wait to meet you as well. And I'm quite excited to meet you, your dog. And I know you got two spots, I think a working spot and an audit spot. And I'm excited about that. I'm a pretty straightforward person. And I think some people struggle with that. And I think it's important to me. I think, first of all, I'm a really simple person myself. I'm just a family dog trainer. I'm a very simple family dog trainer. I don't do anything fancy. I train the concept of yes and no to dogs. That's all I really do. You can do this, but you can't do that. And I like to break it down with that. And I think a lot of dog trainers out there, they've got, they try to complicate dog training to the point that people just don't understand it anymore. And I struggle with that. And I think a lot of it is because they want to appear to be really intelligent. But you don't need to be. Dog training is pretty basic. It's a pretty basic concept. So anyway, Claire says, hi, Jeff. I'm having a problem with my young dog counter surfing. Oh, we'll get rid of that tonight. I'm trying to do what you suggest and catch him in the act and turn his e-collar up on him and teach him a lesson. But I can never catch him at just the right moment. Any tips since I know how to use the stim a few seconds late? Okay. You can, Claire, you can do this. You literally have to set up the dog. You literally are setting up the dog. So what will the dog grab from the counter? I don't know. What? Turkey breast, chicken, peanut butter and jelly, ham sandwich. Tell me. What will that dog grab? You literally put that on the edge of the counter. You put that on the edge of the counter. The dog cannot miss it. And then you have that dog, the collar already up. High as can go. Some people are going to struggle with this. As high as it can go. And then you set up a video camera or a webcam. I mean, right now I've got a webcam on behind me. I'm actually not using my laptop camera. I've got a webcam. It's a conference camera. It's an HD that you can use. But you can use your, there's a drop cam. You can use your cell phone with your computer. You can be outside of the kitchen window and looking from outside. Remember, remote collars go for half a mile, at least any of the decent ones do. And you wait, and that dog gets up, and you hold that button down for 3 seconds. One, two, three. That dog is going to scream. If it doesn't scream, it's not up high enough, and it's not on tight enough. Some people are going to struggle with this. Remember, 86,400 seconds in a day, 3 seconds of discomfort. All right? Let's scale this, guys. Okay, counter surfing dogs can end up dead. Bottom line. Bottom line. Talk to any vet. Talk to any vet. Dogs come in. You know what kind of pain and discomfort it takes for a dog to come in that has swallowed something like a sock or a bone that has to have it removed? Do you know what they have to do? They knock the dog out, which they could die on the table. They use a very, very sharp tool, and they cut the dog open, cut through layers of skin and muscle and fat, okay? And they cut into the stomach lining, and they remove the item. Then they have to stitch the stomach up, and they've got to then stitch up the rest of the dog. There's a chance the dog can die on the table. There's a chance the dog can get lots of infection. There's a chance the stitching can come undone and then they've got to go back in. And you're looking at $3,500 to $5,000 and it doesn't teach the dog anything. So I don't know about anybody else. I'll take 3 seconds on that remote collar any day of the week. If anybody wants, would you do that to your kids? It's like, shut up. I'd do that to my kids. Of course I would not do that to my kids. Okay. And I wouldn't like make my kids eat out of a food bowl on the ground. And I wouldn't put my kids in a kennel. And I don't take my kids to a vet. And I don't walk my kids on a leash. Okay. That's the stupidest comment in the world. Would you do that to your kids, imbeciles? It's a stupid comment. Do that to my kids. God. No, but I would correct my children and I would scale it to get them to stop. So if my children were sticking their fingers in an outlet, oh, there'd be a correction. If my children were driving drunk, doing drugs, oh, there would be a consequence. If my children were doing something stupid, like not wearing their seatbelt where they could die, yes, I would do something. No, I wouldn't put a remote collar because they're not geared for children. They're geared for dogs. Do that to your kids. And you know how I take my kids' temperature with that little wand thing? Okay, I don't stick a thermometer up their butt like you do to a dog. And just for a heads up, children's temperature and dogs' temperatures are different. Do that to your kids. Claire says, thanks, Jeff. 3 seconds. Got it. Entrapment. Sounds great. Yeah, there you go. Entrapment. Thanks, Claire. We're gonna call that entrapment training. That's great. Yep, entrapment. That's right. You entrap them. Put on your some sort of hat, your entrapment hat. Paul says, thank you for these great webinars, Jeff. My question is, in your experience, is board and train a better option than one-on-one training at the client's location for a dog that exhibits territorial displays of aggression, but only on the dog's property? Thank you. That's a good question. I think board and train is better just in general. I think it's better in general. I think it's just a better option just because you can get more stuff done, and you can always then just correct the dog for being territorial at the owner's house. But you know, with territorial aggression, we always do the shut up and come here. So you stop the dog from aggressing, and then you get the dog to come to you. So, I do. Time 9:37. Let's take a quick break. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show, What Would Jeff Do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning on AM 790, talking business around the world on Solid Canine Training Radio. Welcome back. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show, What Would Jeff Do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning on AM 790, talking business around the world on Solid Canine Training Radio. If you miss any part of this show, you actually can see this two ways. You can actually see it on YouTube, and you can also get it downloaded from iTunes. And I will put both of those links up on my Facebook page by Saturday night this week, because I'll be in Gainesville, Florida. Ann asks, hi, Jeff, my 13-year-old Aussie I've talked to you about before. No real training her whole life. I know my bad. Nah, you're not bad. She's made it this far. She's in a down in place along with my 8-year-old hyper Aussie, also no real training. They're loving it. Thank you. Great. Good. That's the thing. And there's always, as you know, there's always time for training. A lot of people struggle with that. They're like, oh, I don't have any time. Yeah, you do. You got, even if you want to watch Dancing with the Stars, I don't even know if that's on anymore. I don't watch television. Your dog can be in place. Everybody's got time for training. I mean, right now, Uma's right behind me. She's sleeping. Uma's right behind me, but I could have her in place. But she travels behind me in the RV. She travels on the couch. That's her spot. She sleeps there. She stays there. She doesn't need as much exercise anymore like she used to. I do a little bit of bite work with her on the road, and then I do a little bit of ball, a little bit of fetch. It's really hard, though. I got to be really careful about running her too hard because she'll pay for the next day with being in pain. And then she pays for it the next day. And out here, I got to be careful. They've got coyotes right behind my RV. There's some coyotes, from what I understand. So that'll be fun tonight. Maybe I'll hear some coyotes. So, Sharon, I have a great rescued shepherd who ran wild for at least 3 months. He was 15, 18 months old then. I'm his third foster 2 years ago, working him on the educator, but I'm terrified to let him off leash. Very hard to catch back then. Do you think it's possible to overcome the wild time? Kudos to you, Sharon, first of all, for rescuing this dog. Okay. Keep him on a 50-foot leash. All right. Keep them on a 50-foot leash and use the remote for your training. That's what we do. Don't let them off leash yet. 50-foot leash, 25-foot leash, but I prefer a 50. And work them in an enclosed football field or baseball field or a tennis court and get them to come back. So that's not the wilderness, I understand. But think about it. If he's on a leash and you cannot turn him back, it a split second, he's not ready to be off leash. All right? So what I want you to do is I want you to practice on your recalls. I want you to practice. He goes out, call him back. He should be spinning on a dime, spinning on a dime, spinning on a dime. You can't get that dog to spin on a dime. Dog's not ready. That's with no distractions. Then you give that dog some distractions and you'll, and then you see how, you know, what he does. Also, the dog needs to be on correction level as well. So what happens is if the dog does not listen and you go up high on the remote, what does the dog do? I want to make sure that dog goes, okay, gotcha, I'm coming back. Or does the dog go, wow, I don't know what that is, I'm running away from it. So the dog has to make sure it goes through the correction phase before you let it off leash truly. But work the dog on a long line for a while. How long? Do it for a month, 2 months. Don't worry about it. Well, how old is that dog? Two? Plenty of time. Plenty of time. Do your work now. Do your work now, and you don't have to worry about it. People were commenting, I got my first haircut in 10 years. It was funny. When I went, and everyone wants to know, it's like, you know, no, I didn't chop all my hair off. What are you, nuts? I'm keeping my hair long, as long as I've got it. You know, it's enough. I'm going bald. I'm going to be 50 years old next year. Let me keep my hair as long as I want, as long as I can. Gives me power, gives me strength, sexual virility. And if my wife was here, she'd be like, when does this happen, Jeff? I know. If you know Linda, that's what she would say. And we would both laugh together and fall back in love. All right. Not back in love. We are in love. All right. So I posted a picture of that on Facebook. If you're not on my Facebook page, join my Facebook page. I'm a social media guy. You know, I put up some videos today. Everything is social media. Everything is social media. It's great. It's great that I can connect with people. I love it. I really love it a lot. Something I want to talk about. You know, I talk to people every day. They put in, they want to do boarding trains with us at the training center. And sometimes people go, ooh, 3 weeks. I don't know if I can leave my dog for 3 weeks. And I say to them, that's something really to think about. You know, the other day somebody asked me, they said, oh, can we, you know, do I call every day? Do we get daily updates? And I'm thinking, you know, and I verbalize this to them. I said, you should think about that statement. Why do you need to find out every day how your dog is doing? Why do you need to find out? Why do you need to find out? That's probably why your dog has separation anxiety. That's probably why your dog is struggling, right? It's something to think about. It's something to think about that you can't leave your dog. And I understand one of my dog's girls, she's at, Carol, we'll see you later. You'll be able to catch this on Saturday, the full thing. Carol, you're going to have to start staying up late for these. All right? Girl's at narcotics school, and she'll be there for like, I don't know, probably 5 or 6 weeks now. Because I was going to pick her up like this week, but then I decided, you know what, let's just keep her there for 3 more weeks, get some more training. So let her get some more training. I called maybe twice in 3 weeks and just to see if he needs anything. And I got to send some more dog food to him. And he sent me a couple pictures of her working. She's training on marijuana, heroin, cocaine, and meth. Just to show me some pictures of her working. That's it. She's fine. She's in good hands. Guy knows what he's doing, right? You know, this is a dog that was with me 24/7, but she's working. So So I send my dogs away too. So I know exactly what you're struggling with. So what's the appropriate age to start a pup on a prong collar? Daughter has a young rowdy pup and a 14-month-old daughter. Need to get, okay. So I don't know, how old's the dog? Your daughter's 14 months old. Okay. And also make sure your daughter gets in on this, Joy. Your daughter should be asking these questions too. I just want to make sure that the people that own the dogs are invested in the training. That's the most important part, is that the people that have got the dogs are the ones that are invested in the training. So that's really, really important. Depends on the size of the dog, but a slip lead will get you a long way too. So if you use a basic slip lead, that's going to get you a lot of results, but depends on the size. Usually 14 weeks, but if it's a tiny, tiny dog, you can use a slip lead. But also the dog, if all these puppies, they should be all getting food trained at the beginning. Everything should be on food. The dog should be only working for food. The only time this dog should eat is when it's working. So dog works for food, works for food, works for food, and then boom, goes back in its kennel. So, and with a 14-month-old daughter, this dog, you know, this dog should be in its crate. Depends on how old it is, for 3/4 of its day. So don't feel bad. A lot of people struggle with that. It's funny. A colleague of mine got a dog this week. They ended up bringing it back to the breeder, and because I told them to. I think I scared them. They got a puppy, and I was pretty much explaining to them what they had to do with this puppy. And they realized how much work it's going to be. And, you know, it's easy to, you know, say bad things, which I would never do. But they were smart. They brought the dog back to the breeder, which was fine. And the breeder took the dog back, which is what breeders are supposed to do. It was only for 24 hours. And probably wasn't thought out that much, but no big deal. Excuse me. Ask your questions, guys. Ask your questions down in your chat box. I can't take phone calls today. I can't take phone calls. You know, it's really funny. It's funny that sometimes that so many people, I'll hear what Joy says. Yes, they're in training, but not sure where to begin. And I'm just mom. The pup is 4 months old. The Schnauzer poodle cross. Yeah. 16 weeks old for a Schnauzer poodle. They can do a small prong collar, but I would get them to do, all food training, do food training. I'm not talking about, you know, treat training. I'm talking about food. So there's a difference between, I was highly, highly outspoken against treat training, and I still am. Food training I've learned about just in the last year, and now I'm a big advocate of it. The reason is because I was always taught 10 years ago treat training, but it wasn't working with aggression rehab. But food training, using the dog's daily food, that's a different story. That's a different story. So you can try it at this age, but I would do more food training and slip lead, food training and slip lead, and duration work, and then also get the dog to learn how to be in its kennel a lot, learn how to love to be in its kennel. Right? They can do it, but you got a 14-month-old, you know, daughter running around too. That's a lot of energy, and those are prime biting moments. A 14-month-old daughter is a prime biting candidate for a puppy. So let's keep our eye on that. All right. Folks should go to, we'll take a quick break, but folks can go to rvdogtrainer.com, and see my schedule. I'll be in Gainesville actually this weekend. There's still some audit spots available in Gainesville. They're only $100 for 2-day seminar. Think about that, $100 for 2 days. Boy, the things you're going to learn. It's incredible. There'll be dog trainers there and dog owners. It's geared towards dog owners. A lot of helpful stuff comes out of there. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, my weekly call-in radio show. What Would Jeff Do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning on AM 790, Talking Business. Around the world on Solid Canine Training Radio. Welcome back. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show. What Would Jeff Do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning on AM 790, Talking Business. Around the world, I have to apologize for my voice, losing my voice. Seems to be happening a lot. I know it's been on the road too, and I'm taking pretty good care of myself. I'm eating really well. Oh, geez, I love it. I love, you know, if you have, I've shown pictures of the RV. Maybe I'll do a tour. That's what I'm going to do. I'll do a little video tour tomorrow when I wake up. I'll do a little video tour. I'll wait till it's nice and light, open up the shades, do a little video tour of the RV. And, but it's got, it sleeps six comfortably. I've got a shower, I've got a full bathroom, refrigerator, freezer, two separate things. I've got a three burner stove. I've got an oven. I've got a double sink. I've got a microwave. I got storage out the wazoo. That's a technical term, by the way, out the wazoo. I've got a generator. Right now, I'm plugged in right now. I'm staying at someone's home, so I'm plugged in. I've got a water source and electrical source, which is really, really nice. I never stay at campsites, so I guess they call that dry camping. I usually stay at Walmart parking lots, hotel parking lots, truck stop parking lots. I just had a new battery system with an inverter, 6,000 watt inverter installed. I want to give a big shout out to Bay City RV. They're down in, they're not in Mobile, Alabama. Where's the town they're in? I'll get you the name of the town. But David is the owner there. And this guy is, my RV broke down. And he literally saved me. They're in Theodore, Alabama. Is there such a thing? Theodore, Alabama. And boy, he saved my butt. He really did. He really did. I'm going to make a video on what happened. Jay, is your T3 program geared towards trainers only or aspiring? Definitely aspiring trainers, Jay. Definitely. Definitely aspiring trainers. So our target market is aspiring trainers and very beginner trainers. But also experienced trainers can come there and get a whole new look on their dog training. But absolutely, aspire. You do not have to be a dog trainer to go there. I would say more than 50% of the people that are there are not practicing dog trainers. Or the other 50%, probably half of those are just doing it part-time. And then the other people are just thinking about doing it. All right. So absolutely, T3 is a great program. And we've got one coming up in Dallas. It's our first time in Dallas. It's going to be fantastic. You can go to Train the Trainers with Sean and Jeff. And it's just a life-changing 6 days now. It's a six-day one. Great. It'd be great to see you in Dallas. You know, that's another thing that people, guys, about my seminars, whether it's Train the Trainers or if it's RV. So a lot of times someone will say, do one in Connecticut. Okay. I'm not going to do one in Connecticut. Majid, I'm going to be in Dallas. I'm actually driving through Houston. Yes, I'm driving through Houston. Next week, I'm driving. My first official stop is Austin, but I'll be driving through Houston. But I'm going to be in Dallas doing a seminar, a six-day seminar, the last week of the month. I'm doing a six-day seminar. I'm driving through Austin, though. I'm going to be spending a couple days in Austin with a colleague. But I think I'm driving through Houston to get to Austin. I'm pretty sure I'm coming up that way. I haven't looked at a map yet. All depends where I want to go. But I'm pretty sure I'm going through Houston. I went through Houston too, when I went across the country. I'll be going through Houston again, probably in November. But Houston is just a pass-through location. It's not a stop for me. Austin's a stop, and Dallas is a big stop. But this is the thing, that if you really want to, like my RV seminar that I'm doing in Gainesville, people are going to drive up to 10 hours away to go to it. Like I have driven 10 hours to go to somebody else's seminar. You know, no, I'm not coming to your town. I can't always come to your town. That's the great thing about travel. You see that someone's having a seminar somewhere and you travel to it. So if you really wanted to see somebody bad enough, you would travel to it. So they don't always come to, you know, your town, especially some of the smaller towns. So, people, Gainesville is like, we're talking Alabama, Louisiana, Mississippi, Georgia, Florida. All people from all those states will be at the seminar. Michelle asks, how long should a four-month-old pup spend in place while training? 16-week-olds, I would try to get up to half an hour. And then by the time you start doing that, the dog will fall asleep anyway. So then you're looking at a couple hours. Okay. Claire asks, regarding the prong collar, again, I'm using a 2.25 for my lab puppy who's now 50 pounds, right at the threshold. When should I switch to 3mm? And I'm using the e-collar too, but still need the prong on walks to keep the leash loose. Okay. So you probably can possibly can get away with always using the 2.25. You just might have to add some links. But Claire, let's get you going on some remote collar healing, right? Let's get you going on some remote collar healing. You should be doing some remote collar healing with that dog to get that loose leash and to get that dog from focusing more on you. So let's do that. All right. Majid, I would drive to Florida, but I figured out too late and couldn't set up my schedule. I'll try to catch you in Austin. Do I get dates on your website? Yeah, but I'm not going to be, Austin is not, Austin is just a colleague. I'm just hanging out with a colleague. So that's me. I'm actually going to be going to a colleague to learn some stuff. I'm actually going to learn how to do a forced fetch, which is if I've got any hunting people out there, they know what the forced fetch is. I'm going to learn how to do the forced fetch. And then I'm going to do some, just some chit chat with a colleague of mine, in Austin. I might visit some people as well, but I'm losing my train of thought here. It's been a long day, these 5 a.m. days. But yes, you can go to RV Dog Trainer, and then you can also go to Train the Trainer with Sean and Jeff. Michelle says, thank you. You're welcome. Ann says, I'm coming to Dallas. I'm not a trainer, but I'm so excited. Can't wait. Ann, I can't wait to meet you. It's going to be so much fun. It's life-changing stuff, Ann. Be prepared. We just did this Accelerate. Program down in New Orleans. You know, this is the thing about Accelerate. This is the thing about Accelerate. The Accelerate program was 2 days. The description of it literally is probably about 5,000 word description. I just posted it up on my Facebook page of what happens. The biggest thing with dog trainers today is dog training is the easy part. Believe it or not. Dog training is the easy. Joyce says, good night. We will begin our 10-hour drive to Gainesville on Friday. Drive safe. Awesome. I'll see you then, Joy. This is the thing. Dog training is the easy part. It absolutely is. I'm a family dog trainer. It's really not that difficult to do what I do. But once you start charging people money for it, you're not a dog trainer anymore. Now you're a business owner. Most dog trainers have terrible people skills. That's why they got into dog training. But the thing is this. If you want to be a professional dog trainer, you're going to have to learn how to deal with people. And a lot of people struggle with fear issues, anxiety issues, depression issues, self-esteem issues, prosperity issues. Did you know that there's people out there that actually are afraid to make money? Think about that concept. There's people that are afraid to make money. And some people, the problem is with dog trainers, when you start charging money, people start thinking you don't care about the dogs anymore. And you're made to feel guilty. That's like me telling my lawyer, oh, why aren't you giving me free legal advice? What, you don't care about me? You only care about making money? Well, you know, if I didn't have money, I couldn't do a lot of the things that I'm doing. I have no prosperity issues. Of course, I want to make a lot of money. I want to make a ton of money. But this webinar is free. Monday's webinar was free. Saturday's webinar is free. Right? My Gainesville RV trip, I got tickets for $100 for 2 days, I assure you, there's no profit there. There's no profit there. So because I make a lot of money, I can tour the country training dogs. And yes, I charge for my RV seminars, but I assure you, it's not a moneymaker for me. Most of that money actually goes towards fuel for this vehicle that I'm driving in. But I do it as my big thank you. I do it as my big thank you. And I do it because I don't want to see people struggle anymore. You know, frankly, I'm sick and tired of 4 million dogs being killed. And I'm also sick and tired of dog trainers not being able to stop basic commands, basic obedience stuff. So those 2 days we do for Accelerate are really powerful. They're really powerful. I encourage anybody to look at the curriculum. Whether you're into dog training or not, I want you to look at that curriculum. Go to the Accelerate. Go to my Facebook page. I put up that post yesterday or the day before. Read the description of what Accelerate is and say to yourself, wow, I don't even train dogs, but I want to go to that. Bingo. Yeah. And anybody that owns their own business should be going to Accelerate. We gear them towards dog training, but you can go anyway, and you would get a ton out of it. A ton out of it. It's really incredible stuff. It's incredible. Ann says, Jeff, working on thresholds with all four of my dogs, is it necessary that they like stand at attention or sit before I take them out? Not only do they have to stand at attention, Ann, but they've got to salute you as well. They can just wait patiently. That's all. Just have them wait. I don't care. Do you care? Just have them wait. So nobody rushes the threshold. That's it. And then what I would do, and I would just like let them go. Just like, you know, so one at a time, let them go. So boom, 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 let them go. Right, Ann? Ann says, there's no profit on the exceptional free videos where I and so many others have learned so much. So again, thank you. You're right. That's another good point, Ann. You're right. You know, my videos, we've gotten, what is it? They've been viewed 1.3 million times, I think. Something like that. 13 million minutes or something. Some astronomical amount of time my videos have been. And it's not like they're like, each video is seen by, you know, hundreds of thousands of people like Beyonce has. Yeah, I put videos out. Those are all free too. Thank you, Ann. That's the thing, is that I'm a big advocate for everything you know you should give away. Everything. Give it away. Give it all away. I mean, here's a good example. If my lawyer, my business lawyer, gave away everything, I'd still hire him. Why? I'm lazy, right? I don't want to do my own legal work. Some stuff you can't do, but I don't want to. You know, my accountant, I could do all my own accounting. All of it. I don't have to pay him. I don't want to, right? Let him do it. Okay. I could rake all my own leaves, shovel my snow. I don't want to. I got somebody that does that. Why? Because I want my time. That's why. I want time. I want time. I'd rather be with my children, and I'd rather be with Linda, frankly, than raking leaves. I'm sure there's going to be some smartass that says, well, have him rake leaves with you. Yeah, I know. You're right. Take a quick break. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show. What Would Jeff Do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning on AM 790, talking business around the world on Solid Canine Training Radio. Welcome back. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show. What Would Jeff Do? Talking to you live this Saturday morning, AM 790, talking business around the world on Solid Canine Training Radio. Jay says, I've seen you working a dog on the stand command. I forget the dog's name at your center. The technique I'm using is not working. What's your technique of learning that command? We do it with food, and we just do it with, so what we're doing with the stand command is, so we've got the dog you can do it a couple. Usually your dog is in a sit, and there's a bunch of food in front of your hand, and then you say stand. You can even use the leash, and you move your hand backwards, and you could give the dog leash pressure, and then it goes into a stand. And then you say break, and you give the dog the food. And then you can do that sit. You say stand, use a little bit of leash pressure, move your hand back, so the dog is lured into your hand. So the thing is, folks, if you want to ask questions, make sure you ask them, put them to admin only, and put them in the message box right below. All right. You can ask me your dog training questions. I'll give you an answer. The dogs have got to be hungry. So we use the dog's daily food for training. We use the dog's daily food for training. So it's not treats. It's not extra stuff. It's the dog's food. So the dogs are hungry. The dogs are nice and hungry. So if you don't work, you don't eat. Some people struggle with that. Some people think we're starving the dogs. And no, we're not starving the dogs. We're asking the dogs to do simple stuff. We're getting their food drive up. And we still use all the other tools. We still correct dogs. It's what the balance of balanced training is. You still do all our remote training. But remember, your remote should be motivating dogs. All your work should be motivating the dogs. Even the word no should be a motivational tool. It's important. Sharon says, I would love to help people train their dogs, but then I remember that I'm 69. How that happened? Freaking days, man. 369 times 365. Is that ridiculous? Maybe specialize in work with other seniors. I already do have a small pet supply business. So this is the thing, Sharon. Number one, you absolutely, positively could train dogs professionally. I want you to know that. All right, Sharon? I want you to know that I don't care that you're 69 years old and either do any of the other people. And you don't have to be working with man-eaters, and you probably shouldn't be. Okay? But I want you to know there are so many families struggling out there. So many families are struggling. 4 million dogs a year are being killed. 4 million. 22 to 26 million dogs enter homes every year, and we've got 200 to 220 million dogs already in homes. There is so much opportunity for dog training. I can see you making your own videos. I can see you having your own radio show, your own webinar. Anybody can do this webinar, guys. I'm in the middle of, I don't want to say I'm in the middle of nowhere, but I'm in my RV doing a webinar right now. Think about that. It's live. I'm doing a live webinar in my RV. As long as I've got a Wi-Fi signal, I can do a webinar. Hold on, I'm losing my voice. Fellow Workers Farm. Great stuff. More stuff that Linda gives me. I got a whole drawer of stuff. If I ever get sick, I just look in that drawer what to do. She takes care of me. She's got these great vitamins for me. AM vitamins, PM vitamins, apple cider vinegar. What else? She's got everything. So I want you to know, Sharon, you could make a killing. Sharon, this doesn't sound get quick rich. I can show you how to make $100,000 training dogs, even at 69. I'm telling you. The work I do is not that hard. I want you to know that. I'm not saying this so you'll go to T3. That's not what I'm doing. All right? This is not what this is about. Okay? It's not what this is about. What it is Sharon, the people are in pain. Families are in pain. You actually have the power to stop it. How awesome is that, Sharon? How awesome is that? Irene says, hi, Jeff, you're amazing, your level of energy. Oh, thank you. You're all over the country and in Europe and still operate at such a high energy level. Irene, I'm dragging today. This is not high energy at all. I'm literally dragging. This is rough. Today's a rough one. Every once in a while, you guys catch me at a rough time. I bet you the last I don't know, in the last 3 months, probably half the webinars have been challenging for me. And but Europe was great. Yeah, gosh, yeah, Europe was great. Europe was fantastic. I loved it in Germany. I want to get back. I'm going to get back. I was looking at my schedule. I was looking at my schedule, my calendar. It's just really filling up my travel schedule between mostly seminars, and then I got shadow people coming in. I got shadow people coming into my training center. You can shadow us. And you don't just shadow me. You shadow John. You shadow me. You shadow, learn about the front desk, the business parts of it. And there's so much great. This is such a great time. We're living in a great time. We're living in the most one of the most powerful, wonderful times to be alive right now. You know what I always tell people? This is what I want people to think about. Hey, Vanessa, how are you? I miss you, hon. Love you. Glad you're feeling better. This is the thing. Ask yourself this question. What's the biggest impact that you can have on the world? Everybody, think about this. Ask yourself this question on a serious note. And if you don't know, start writing it down. What's the biggest impact you can have on the world? And why aren't you doing it? Think about that. What's the biggest impact you can have on the world? And why aren't you doing it? That's my philosophy. That's my passion. That's what I'm doing. It's not working with dogs. It's working with people. Okay? There's no dogs here. Well, Uma. It's people. I love people. I love them. I love them. I love them. I love you guys. I love to eliminate pain in people. You know, the nice thing about being down in New Orleans, kindness of strangers, the friendliness of people. You say hello to people, they say hello back. Something to be said. Something to be said. So Irene says, hi, Jeff, you're amazing at your level of energy. You're all over the country and in Europe and still operate at such a high energy level. Amazing. In one of your videos, you have a dog roll over on the other side for grooming. Do you have a video on teaching? No, I don't have a video on teaching rollover, but just do it with food. Just do it with food. Just take food. You can even do food with a leash, and you can just do, just start with the food on one side, and you just go like that. And then you go like that. Just do that. You can use a little bit of leash pressure. All right, you do a little bit of leash pressure too. Okay, AJ, hi Jeff. What would you recommend I carry with me on structured walks to ward off aggressive dogs that I might encounter in my neighborhood? Unfortunately, I live in a neighborhood with several incompetent dog owners who allow their dogs to run at large, want to avoid having my dog be attacked or injured. That's a great thing, AJ, and it's happening more, and problems like that are happening more and more. What I would do is I would carry a pet convincer, number one. Pet convincer is compressed air. You can also use bear spray. Bear spray is going to be more powerful than mace. You can also carry a walking stick. You can also carry a stun stick. The bottom line is this. You got to neutralize that. You got to neutralize. You know, I talk like a military person, and I'm not in the military, but I respect the military to a high level. You have to neutralize the threat. Sorry, you can't come to me. So if I'm walking my dog, if I'm with my kids, if I'm by myself, I'm old-fashioned. If I'm with my wife, I'm old-fashioned. Uh-uh. Nope. Nope. I protect my family. Okay? It's my job. I protect my family. So I'll do whatever it takes. So when off-leash dogs comes at me, it will not reach me. I won't do it. Won't let it. So you can pick up rocks from the ground, throw it at them, scream at them. And if a neighbor is screaming at you, tell them to get their dog back. Or get your dog back. They say their dog's friendly. It's not the point if their dog is friendly or not. The thing is that your dog's on a leash. Their quote-unquote friendly dog comes up to your dog. I see it all the time. I've seen people walk up to each other where they're both their dogs on a leash, sniff, sniff, sniff. Next thing you know, dog fight. Happens all the time. And both owners are surprised. What did you think was going to happen? Your dogs are on a leash. you're pulling your, you know, you're, they're on a leash with tension and they're pulling at you. So I would do all those things. We still got time for questions, guys. Let me take a quick break. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my weekly call-in radio show. What would Jeff do talking to you live this Saturday morning on AM 790, talking business around the world on Solid Canine Training Radio? I got to do these breaks, guys, because these are going to be, this show is going to be podcast on Saturday for my radio show. Welcome back. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, my call-in weekly radio show. I'm actually in Ellington, Florida. I'm at a colleague's house, Tracy, and she's nice enough to let me park the RV and in her lot. In her, and she's actually, I'm plugged in with water and electric, which is great because it gets hot down here, so I don't have to run my generator. And we're going to train some dogs tomorrow. We're going to eat some barbecue tomorrow. We're going to train more dogs. We're going to eat more barbecue. We'll train more dogs, but we're ending the day on barbecue. That's what I'm committed to. End of the day on barbecue. Oh, can't wait. Can't wait till I go to Texas. That's barbecue. Oof. Last time I was in Austin, I ate some good barbecue. I was down in New Orleans. I had some gumbo. I had some alligator. I think there's only po' boy. I don't know, guys. I don't know about these po' boys. It's a sub sandwich. It's a grinder. It's a hoagie. Call it what you want. I don't understand what the po' boy is. Po' boy, is that's supposed to be what? I don't get it. Po' boy, it's a grinder. It's a sub sandwich. It's a hoagie. You know, each region calls it something different. They call it po' boy. I thought po' boy was gonna be something great. I mean, they did have a. Evie says hi, Jeff. Hi. If you have a question, put it in there. I'd love to hear your question. They had like an oyster, deep fried oyster. Now, that's a little bit different, but to me, looked like a sub sandwich. Tasted like a sub sandwich. Looked like a sub sandwich. I'm calling it a sub sandwich. I ain't calling it a po' boy. So, what else is on my list? Let's see, Dallas. A lot of people also think about they're running their dogs to try to get the dogs to behave. You don't have to have a tired dog to have a well-behaved dog. Just remember that. Your dog does not have to be tired to be well-behaved. You actually can have a dog, you know, you can have your dog just be calm by teaching it to be calm. Weird concept, right? So I'm not against exercise at all. I mean, we exercise the heck out of dogs. We would have, you know, but teach it how to just do a lot of nothing. Teach it how to do a lot of nothing. So that's what I would do. That's what I would do. All right. So let's get your questions in. Jeff in California says, hi, Jeff, you're probably addressed before, but can you go over your protocol for the out command? Pass phase one of the LAPD process, phase two next week. Oh, congratulations. Also making really amazing progress with a German Shepherd dog. Whining and separation anxiety dropped by 90% third day in. Good for you. Out command we do with remote collar. We teach out for everything, whether you're doing it for a ball, something that they do want or something they're not supposed to have. Remote collar on. I've got a video on this. Remote collar on. Say they've got a ball. You say out. Tap your remote collar. They usually spit the ball out. Pick up the ball. Throw the ball. If your dog's got high ball drive, it's not going to make a difference. For their food bowl, we also do out for their food. If you want to feed dogs with a food bowl, we do the default waiting for food. But then we also do the out command. Same thing with the food bowl. When it comes to a food protocol, we want to do out. We tap the button of the remote. We don't want the dog just to move away out of the with its body. We also want the dog to move away with its mind. So that's really, really important. So when you're talking about out with food bowls or bones, you want them to move away with their mind. When you're doing it with a ball, you want them to just physically move away so you can pick it up without having them bite you. There's a great video of Angelo I put up last week of him saying out he was 1.5 at the time. This was last summer. He says out in one of my German Shepherds spit the ball right out, and he picks it up, and there's no worry that dog's gonna go back in for the ball whatsoever. So that's how I do the out. But Jeff, congratulations on you for going through the LAPD phase two next week. Good for you. You must be really excited. I'm super proud of you. I'm also proud of you that you're doing your dog training too. It's really, really great. You know, for all the young dog trainers out there, you know, another thing that I want to talk to is that a lot of people in our industry that have been dog training for, you know, 20, 30, 40 years, that should be our mentors, you just got a bunch of mean old washed up people, in my opinion. That's all you got, right? That's disrespectful, isn't it? Oh, well, you know, you're supposed to be mentoring all these young dog trainers. And I'm sorry, but treating young dog trainers poorly and mean is no way to mentor. Maybe you should look up what a mentor is. Mentor is to teach and empower and to motivate somebody that is interested in the same thing you are. Or you can mentor somebody through life. And you don't do that by treating them poorly or to see how much abuse they can take so they should have a thick skin. That's not what a mentor is. And there's a lot of people in my industry that, frankly, I wouldn't even sit down at the same table with, and they're supposed to be mentors. They got a long way to go. You know who's becoming the best mentors out there? Are people that have been dog training for 10 years and under. Those are the people that are becoming the best dog trainer mentors out there. Because guys, it's dog training. It ain't that hard. So, and I think they get mad. They get so many of these older dog trainers get mad at people that are utilizing social media and videos to promote their craft, to promote their business. Okay, sorry, Yellow Pages ain't working anymore. All right. Anyway, Claire, trying to comment, but it's not going through. Huh. All right. That's fine. Question then. Thanks for all your encouragement. I'm turning 62 next month, and I'm just trying to help one dog at a time. Oh my gosh, awesome. Along with the owner, the people are the hardest to train. Good night, Jeff. Claire, the people are very hard to train. Kudos to you for 62. Look at you. I'm so proud of you. That's really great. One dog at a time is great too. One dog at a time is really fantastic. You're helping a lot of people. Think about it. If everybody helped one dog, we'd be doing great. AJ, I'm planning on buying another female male and wild adult dog. I would have her separated from my other dogs for a long time. Do you have any do's or don'ts you can recommend as far as getting the dogs familiar with each other? First of all, you're getting a male. If you're an experienced handler, which I'm going to assume you are, but there's that movie coming out soon. I forgot the name of it. Max, Saving Max or something. Guys, if you get a male and you expect it to be a family dog, it's not going to be. Okay, it won't. Malinois are genetically designed to bite things. They actually need, I rarely ever talk about genetics, and I rarely ever talk about breed. But a Malinois needs to bite things. That's what it does. It bites. And I don't think a family should get a Malinois. As far as what you should do, AJ, is let's make sure the dog is balanced. Make sure that you do high amounts of structure. The dog should be kenneled at all times when you're not working it. So the thing about Malinois, they got no problem being in kennels, or they shouldn't have it. If they were raised properly, they shouldn't have any actually any dog shouldn't have a problem being in a kennel that was raised properly. And then you want to see what happens as far as the dog's energy, teach her the concept of yes and no, start getting around one of your balanced dogs, two of your balanced dogs. I'm not sure how many dogs you have. And then what we do with our socialization, we use a dressage whip. You can also use a remote collar if you want. If the dog makes the bad choice, see how it does. If you want to take it on walks, go migration forward, you can do that. So that's a great thing to do. Yeah, Jeff, you got to go back. Jeff says, sweet, missed that one. We'll go back and find it. Thanks, as always, for your support and all you do. Oh, Jeff, thank you. Remember, without students, I can't teach. You know, without students, I can't teach. And I'd love it if some of the more experienced dog trainers got off their high horses and their huge egos and came down a couple steps and started actually doing true mentorship. True mentorship. All right. With young trainers. And I want all my young trainers out there, you know, hey, I've only been training dogs for a little bit more than 10 years. But you don't have to, you know, clean up, you know, 1,000 pounds of dog poop before you deserve to be dog training. You know, most of my clients, I would say 50% or more of my clients could become professional dog trainers after just learning how to train dogs with me. Think about that. It's not that difficult. It's not that difficult to do. So it's important. And I know that's a big topic, I'm sure, in a lot of different people's industries, but in my industry specifically, frankly, I'm not impressed at all. I'm not impressed at all. We got a lot of dog trainers been around for a long time. You guys are letting down our industry. You're letting down the young dog trainers. Okay. You're being rude. Okay. You're sitting around. You're drinking too much. You're being rude. You're using social media to bash other people, insult other people, talk behind their backs. You're being mean. You know, words hurt. You know, you realize that, and you're being very unprofessional. And there's no such thing as private. Okay. So all the bashing that's going on all these private pages, it's not private. Why? I see it, and I'm not part of those private pages. I'm seeing it. I'm hearing it. You know? So anyway, follow-up comment. I have two Malinois already. They're high-drive and high-energy dogs. I don't recommend them as family pets because of the needs. I agree with you about having them as pets. Cool, AJ. So yeah, so get your Mals. Cool. Kudos to you, buddy. And glad you're getting an adult one, too. So what you're going to do is you just got to you're going to get that one male that you get and just put them in your system, right? Put them into the system. That's what I always tell people. Get the dog, put it in the system, and just run that dog right through the system and you'll do fine. You'll do fine. If you need my help, you know, you can always send me a video. Let me know. Jay says, I can't say your first word because this is going to be on the radio. I wanted to get a Mal. You know, put it this way, Jay. I've been thinking about getting a Mal. I've been, but I'm not. And I know how to work dogs. You know, we thought about getting a Mal for, and if you really want to get a Mal, wait 6 months. You know how many Malinois are going to be out, up for adoption and turned into shelters in the next 6 months to a year after this movie comes out? A ton of them. Ton of Malinois are going to be in shelters. Watch. Just like 100, when 101 Dalmatians came out, how many Dalmatians ended up in shelters? When, what's that Chihuahua movie with that, what's that person's name that thinks she's an actress? Forgot. No. She is an actress. No, I'm thinking of the movie star. That's Reese Witherspoon. She is the actress. There was that one. But who's that? Hilton person. Oh, Paris Hilton. She got a little Chihuahua and everybody wanted a Chihuahua. All the Chihuahuas end up in shelters. So, all right, folks. End of the show. It's been Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, my weekly call-in radio show, What Would Jeff Do? And I can't thank everybody enough for tuning in. What I want everybody to do is they can go to rvdogtrainer.com, solidcaninetraining.com, and train the trainer. Train the Trainers with Sean and Jeff.com. You can see what we're up to. And this show will be the Saturday radio show. I'll be doing another live webinar on Monday night. I'll be doing another live webinar on Monday night. And I will be, I don't know where I'll be. I'll be definitely, I'm going to be out of Florida, heading to Austin, Texas. So I'll let you know all then. All right. I'm madly in love with you guys. Thanks a lot.